Why is existence like a ghost pepper? I will tell you why it's like a ghost pepper. Because it's when you go into a new cycle, it's like eating a ghost pepper. We're about ready to go into a new cycle of existence. When I say we, I'm not speaking for myself, I'm speaking for most. I'm certainly not going to. But we're full of trepidation. And when we get into a new cycle of what it really is mortality training. Existence is mortality training. It's a mortality training program. MTP, mortality training program. And we say, wow, this is going to be pretty intense. So we bite the pepper. And first it's like, got some earth tones. A little bit of sort of citrusy taste, kind of an off taste. I can't quite place this one. It's sort of some kind of pungent, exotic pungent taste there. Very intriguing. Nice peppery, very nice peppery, strong taste, very intense. Not so bad. Very nice. I kind of like it. It's full of intrigue. I'm really kind of intrigued, actually. And a little bit of heat, a little warm, a little build. Not so bad. This new cycle of existence is starting out to be really, really intriguing. I'm really with it. It's not as bad as I thought at all. A little more heat, a little more build. And that's not so hot. Nah, I thought it'd be worse. And I'm now starting to build a little more heat. Yeah, it's hot. That's hot. It's still building. Starting to build. I'm starting to feel the heat now. This is really hot. This is really, really hot. It's still building. Welcome to the new cycle of existence, of mortality training. And, it's still building. And it's still like, whoa. This is too intense. This is getting too intense. It's incredible. This pepper is just blowing my mind. It's too hot. I have back on my throat, front of my mouth. I can't breathe. I can't talk. This is too crazy. Over the top, this is too much. And then a little later on, still building, I say, this is insane, totally insane, I regret it, what a stupid thing I did. And then it plateaus, and you're just like, and you're just like, am I alive, am I dead, I don't know. I'm in some kind of altered state, but this is just too intense. It's just like, I don't know what's going on. This is mortality training. So, mortality training is like a ghost pepper, folks, okay? And I'm telling you, this ghost pepper right here, I won't eat it. I'm not going to eat it. I'm tempted. It keeps coming. Come on, don't you want to, Miss Ghost Pepper is here. My, you should try this pepper. It's so nice. I said, no, I don't know. I've tried one before. I said, I know what it's like. cycles of existence. Now, we had the previous video. We showed you how existence is like, cycles of existence are like shaking a bottle with detergent in it and watching all the bubbles stream down. That's what it is. And it just keeps shaking it, shake. So one cycle, shake again, another cycle, shake again, another cycle, shake again, another cycle. And it all keeps thinking this is different, this is interesting. But what happens is once you go through that enough, you shake, here come the bubbles, and you say, you know what, I've seen this before. It's a little different, but it kind of has lost its interest and intrigue. Not so important anymore. It feels stale, feels old. How do I get out of this place? I'm bored, very bored, very bored, very bored. So, the cycles of existence don't turn out the way you think that they will. They get too intense, like a ghost pepper. They get boring. And you finally just say, I've had enough of this. That's it. I can't take it anymore. I really can't take it anymore. And then you try to say, what do I do? I want to just set it down. You say, whoa, I can't set it down because I got a fear of this continuity issue. It's just biting me. And then you start saying, can't anybody help me with this continuity issue? And then, voila, you feel some sort of inner confidence, like something within you knows how to deal with it. What is that? That's the Holy Spirit, put there by God, the Prime Creator. We all have the Holy Spirit within us. Now, given that the times are like a python, the world is like being strangled by a snake, by a giant python, as it were. And you know how pythons work. They slowly, you know, they encircle and circle, softly, gently, with beautiful, glittering colors. You know, the snakes look so beautiful, and they slowly work their way around you. And you think, this is so, look at how beautiful the colors are and everything. And they slowly start tightening. You let out a breath, and they squeeze a little bit so you can't breathe back in. And your breathing comes a little constricted. They're called constrictors, and they gradually constrict you more and more and more and more and more. All the while, with you're looking at their colorful iridescent radiation of their scales and such. More constriction, more constriction. And I breathe. Shallow breathing, anxiety, anxiety. This planet is being constricted by reptilians, actually, and their proxies, the greys, and ultimately by the ego and the mortality training program and fourth dimensionals. We are being constricted, and our breathing is now becoming more and more shallow. Our hearts beating fast because we're not getting enough oxygen in the blood, so the heart has to pump faster. We're feeling, you know, I'm waking up at, you know, 4:30, 3:30, 4:30 in the morning, every morning. It's like, wow, the constriction is getting, you know, very frightening at this point. Now, we need to hear stuff that is a mind blower, really. How do we blow the snake's mind? So it like loosens up. Oh, there's a way, there is a way. I came here to say the things that nobody else will say. Nobody else will say this with the stuff that I'm going to say, have been saying actually, because there's reasons for it. I want to tell you something very amazing, very paradoxical and very amazing. And that is that females, the feminine women, females, that principle has absolutely no role in salvation whatsoever. Zero role. Neither do men. Men have zero role also. But of course, men have no role in this mortality training either. They're just picking the cotton, as a matter of fact. But the females actually run the mortality program. They're in charge, so to speak. The ego is really in charge. The mind is in charge. But as far as the real power in this mortality training program, it's run by females. So females feel that they should also run salvation. They should run that too. But they can't. They don't. It's the Holy Spirit that runs it. And it's easier for men to accept this than it is for women. Because the fact is, again, this planet is just a plantation. It's not a planet, it's a plantation. And men are just picking the cotton. And the women tell men which cotton to pick, when to pick it, actually. And occasionally they give men at least some illusion of autonomy, you know, but they're like the banksters. The females are like the banksters who control the mortgages on the house, and the man may think he owns the house. He doesn't. The bank owns the house. The bank owns the mortgage, and it's upside down and underwater, etc. But the thing is that women, they're so used to being the power, the real power, actually, in this world. It's always been female. In the whole universe, it's a feminine thing because they produce the flesh. That which produces the flesh is the one, the central principal actor in this role of mortality training, absolutely. And they cannot get it that they don't have a role in salvation. They don't. No role. The Holy Spirit has the role. It's the one. What does the Holy Spirit do? It just shakes this bottle. It shakes the bottle, you know. And what happens is suddenly all the bubbles streaming down appear to be unbelievably lovely. Lovely loveliness. So incredibly lovely. The whole thing is like perfect. See, oh my God. This is unbelievably perfect. It reminds me of something. It reminds me of something very ancient. Beautiful and ancient. Ancient, beautiful memory. What is this? It's just giving this powerful reminder. That's how the continuity problem is solved. The Holy Spirit shakes the bottle. Okay? Shakes up the bubbles. And it all appears perfect for us. So, who has a role in that? Nobody, except the Holy Spirit. Our role is just to accept our own salvation. That's it. That's it. So, when you get a guru, for instance, like Muji, who is talking about, you know, the salvation, you see interesting phenomenon is you have this tremendous group of women who come. It's at least 75% at all times, and sometimes 80 and 90% just women. And they're just, oh, Muji, you're just so wonderful, you're so great, I'm just loving you so much. What they're really doing is they're saying, hey, Muji, hey, can you get me a real nice role in salvation? Can you, you know, I'm feeling like I might get left out, and I can't handle that. I've got to be in control. So I'm really begging you, asking you, please, I want a really cherry nice role in the salvation. I've got to be in charge. I've got to, you know. So they're really, it's what you see in the world. There's some, you know, if there's any gurus, it's so much women around them, because they say, you know, they think they can influence the guru to talk to the Holy Spirit, say, hey, Holy Spirit or God, you know, I think they're really wonderful, and you should give them a, you know, a choice role in the plan of salvation. You know, that's what's going on, actually. They're not really there for enlightenment. They're there, hopefully they think they can, that the guru will shine their grace on them and give them the role that they're used to having, which is really being in charge. But they're not in charge of salvation. Never will be. And this is something that, you know, it's like a mind blower for everybody. And men too. Men want women to be in charge because that's the way it's always been. Calling the shots, really calling the shots, and saying, look, this is how it is. This is how it's going to be. Sometimes letting the man think that he's got some say in things, other times not, you know. Especially when we're starting a new cycle of existence, that's when the women stop pretending that they're nice and say, hey, look, buddy, this is how things are. We're in charge. You're going to do what we tell you to do, and we're going to go through another cycle of existence, and we're no more Mrs. Nice anymore. We're, you know, we're taking off our mask, and no nonsense. You know, this time we're really going to learn how to die this time. And so the men are used to that. So they look for some, you know, powerful woman like a goddess or something so that they can be told which god to pick. And it's not there. It's only the Holy Spirit. It's only this beatific vision. That's it. There aren't any roles. But so now you see this dynamic of the guru, and I've always noticed that. I said, you know, it's very odd because they're not really there for enlightenment. No, not really. They pretend like, I'm getting it, I'm almost got it. Is it like this? Is it like that? They're trying to please the guru. Why? To get a role in salvation. They want a role in salvation. Again, the females play no role in salvation whatsoever. None. Never have, never will. And again, men also play no role whatsoever. But they're used to that, actually. They're used to being the cotton pickers. So it's easier for them to accept the Holy Spirit and say, oh, okay, no, I'm not playing any role in it. That's okay. That's fine. No big deal. And women are frantic for men to pretend like they're the ones who, are in charge, etc. Because they don't want the world to see them. The man is just some completely crushed, henpecked man. That they don't want it to be too obvious. They kind of feel a little bit ashamed about it. So they want the man to put up a strong face, like, yeah, I wear the pants at my house. I tell the woman what to do. Oh yeah, sure, right. And then they come home and it's like, yes, dear, you want what? It's like that. So, of course, everybody knows this. It's an open secret, as it were. But again, there's no role for the female in salvation at all. Paradoxically, it might be a good thing. Maybe it has unintended consequences when you accept this and see it. You think, wow, what's going to happen seeing that? And it's not bad. It's like, huh. It's not as bad as you would think. But again, we're at a time now where we're getting ready to start a new cycle of existence. And that's why you see the radical feminists and the whole feminist empowerment movement, etc., is basically to shed the masks of benevolence, so to speak, and crack the whip and say, okay, everybody, we're going to do another one, like it or not, because a lot of people don't want to, you see. A lot of people don't want to. And the females are afraid if enough people say no, they won't have any role to play, If no one will listen to them. They're terrified of it, so they're saying, no, everybody must go through this next cycle. And, we're the queen bees, we're gonna take care of this next cycle. We're in charge. We're gonna produce the flesh, we're gonna tell the flesh what to do, all this kind of stuff. But they're afraid that maybe some people will say, nah, forget it. Be left without a role. So it's an amazing thing to be able to say this, that the truth of the whole situation is a fact. Again, the Holy Spirit is the one that saves us. It's the one that solves the continuity problem. It's the one that plays the role of Savior. Not us. We don't do anything except abide in it. Watch the bubbles. Watch the bubbles. Watch the beautiful bubbles in the jar. That's all we do. So we're at this amazing time in history where, of course, to start a new cycle, one has to come to an end. So they overlap, the ending and the beginning kind of overlap. We're going through this being crushed by the serpent, strangled, constricted by the serpent. We have this now amazing phenomena in the world of women shedding their so-called deferentialness that they were pretending to have in order for the game to kind of play, because people get bored of it, really bored, and so they have to kind of ease up after a while. They can't always be the tyrants that they'd like to be, but they have to ease up, and then when a new cycle comes, they got to get back to that tyrannical aspect of, you guys are going to pick the cotton whether you like it or not. That's just how it is, and tough. Yeah. we don't want to pick the cotton anymore. And they say, well, you're out of luck. You can't be part of this cycle, because that's what you're going to do. Say, well, okay, we'll just drop out of the mortality training program then. So it's amazing. Meditations can be amazing. Very different than you think. You can say, no role. I have no role in salvation. I have no role in salvation. I have no role in salvation. It's a complete change, right? Just unbelievable change. Because all this while, we're fighting for that role. And anybody who comes out as a guru, you're guaranteed, the ladies will flock there and like, oh, yes, you're so wonderful, you're so great. Now, what, you have a role for me, right? You got a really great role for me. I'm ready, I'm here, I'm ready to assume my role. And the real gurus will say, nobody has any role, you don't have a role. No role whatsoever in salvation, no role. Except to accept abide in the vision of Christ, the beautiful bubbles. But that's not really a role. That the way we look at it is just simply, you simply abide. That's it. That's it. That's the only role that anyone ever has in it. That's it. And again, contrary to thinking, what a horrible thing to say, is actually brings up laughter, kind of some kind of laughter. When you meditate on that, just meditate on, I have no role. I don't have any role. I have no role in salvation, none. I don't have any role. Nobody has any role. There are no roles in salvation. In the mortality training program, of course. But if you want to be saved from the cycles of existence, you have to accept that you don't have any role. Just abide in that fact. And again, repentance is all important, meaning accepting you have a continuity problem. Say, I have no role, and I have this incomprehensibly vast continuity problem. Not any definition. But I have no role to play in that either. And this kind of grounds you in salvation, as it were. Does Buji understand? It seems to be somewhat, yeah. I mean, he gets a chuckle out. He says, are you trying to please me? You know, you're trying, yeah. but it can be very intense, and you know, it's remains to be seen, actually, because the women are frantic to maintain their role of control. We don't realize in this world how much control women really have. We don't. It's so all-encompassing that we don't understand it. It really is. It's very difficult to wrap your mind around it. Yeah. That's why people worship the goddess, like Kali. Oh, Kali, you're so wonderful. You give birth to so many, and you chop off everybody's heads. And of course, that's what people want. They're seeking their death. And so they worship that which is, you know, wildly enthusiastic about this mortality program. And the goddess is constantly producing more and more and more and more victims, as it were, the feminine principle. Vast, vast quantities, drunk in the exercise of producing sacrifice, mortality, dead bodies, death narratives that we call a life. And so, of course, they want to, you know, tell the Holy Spirit what to do. Say, oh, we're used to being in charge, Holy Spirit. Don't worry. We know how to do it. can't seduce the Holy Spirit. Cannot. You might be able to seduce a guru. It's happened many times. If you see all these male gurus, one after the other gets seduced. And they don't start out, it doesn't seem like they really want that. But eventually, it gets to them. And just the constant pressure, you know, to give me a role in salvation. I insist. You know, it breaks them down, and before you know it, they're making all sorts of deals with the ladies. And of course, then they get blamed for it, naturally. Yeah, of course, they're always the guy that's bad. You know, always the guy that's bad here in existence. But the relentless pressure, you know, breaks down just about everybody here. And why this frantic desire for a role in salvation? Fear of the continuity problem, plain and simple. You know, everybody wants to avoid. They want, basically what they want to do is run the ego's program. You know, wants that to mean they want to maintain it. They want to maintain this mortality training. It gives them a belief that they're here, that they're born, that this is you can grab a hold of it. There's something to grab a hold of so you don't feel like you're going to suffer from the continuity, tears of the continuity issue. So it's a very intense situation. So being a guru is actually extremely difficult proposition in this world. I mean, it's not a superficial thing. I mean, the guru, the demands are ferocious. Saying you have to give me a big role in salvation. You must. You absolutely must. Name your price. Name your price. Whatever, I'll pay whatever price, but you must give me that. Thinking that the guru's got some influence over the Holy Spirit, it does not. The guru has no influence over the Holy Spirit. Nobody does. Nobody, not even Jesus, not even God. No influence over the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit cannot be influenced. You cannot peddle influence with the Holy Spirit. So the guru doesn't have any. And you say, now sometimes, here's the problem, is the guru might kind of fudge on this thing and kind of say, nah, I got no influence. And then they think, oh no, he's just trying to get a better deal. Well, but, you know, and it's that kind of thing. A tough position, actually, a very tough position. So I think if people recognize this dynamic, it would go better for the world, because you have to understand that this relentless, clever pressure is brought to bear, because people think that the guru has influence on the Holy Spirit, and it's not true. But even when the guru says they don't, it's not believed at all. They say, again, you're just trying to get a better deal. Maybe you don't like me. You don't like me. You don't love me. Why don't you love me? You know, it's just incredible stuff. It's just like, you know, from the male viewpoint, it's like, you know, like hell, absolute hell. Why would anybody want to do that? Muji's one of the, you know, few people who's even tries, you know, because he seems to have this very strong feminine mother aspect too, and he's able to at least, you know, give it a whirl to try to deflect all this, but you wonder, you wonder. It's not. It would not be surprising at all if some stuff is going on. It's not surprising at all. You know, that's what happens in this world. You know, there's this grand romance taking place, a grand romance. The gopis, you know, around Krishna. Hey Krishna, hey Krishna, Hare Krishna. Give us a. What's our role in salvation, Krishna? What's our role? Aren't we beautiful? Yeah. Why don't you give us a nice role in salvation? Now, Krishna should say, it's not up to me, it's up to the Holy Spirit. Nobody has a role in salvation except the Holy Spirit. That's it. You know, you just have to accept the beatific vision of Christ. That solves a continuity problem for you. It's not about roles at all. It's not about roles at all. So, again, a wise planet is wise to this. And so there's a reason why things develop the way they do on this planet to protect against that, actually. You have to take safeguards to keep that from really running amok, this dynamic. This is probably, I think for females, this is the number one dynamic. They're not really interested so much in the other stuff. It's, what's my role? You know, what's my role in salvation? I want to know my role. Just tell me my role. I'm trying to figure out what my role is. That's the great, you know, for women, that is the great path of the great obstacle, the great struggle, the great focus of interest. They want to know what their role is. Again, there is no role. They don't have a role. That's the mind blower. That could lead them to enlightenment, to see that actually. If they can accept it, they don't have any role. And of course, neither do men. Men don't have a role either. Again, for men, rarely, men really don't think about that so much. What's my role? I don't care. I just want to get free of this tyranny. I just want to get free of tyranny is all they're thinking about. But not what my role is. I mean, for me, it's like I care less. I don't really care role. What role? Who needs a role? I just want to feel peace of mind and get free of this terrible tyranny, etc., of this mortality training program. Just get drop out of it. That's it. But again, so there's a big difference between the male and female approach. Very big difference. Huge difference. And the sense I get in looking, watching like a Muji Satsang is the men are just wallflowers there. Just wallflowers. You know, they just, the women completely dominate the Satsang. It's ferocious, intense domination. And the men are just, you know, just accompanying them, maybe, you know, just happy to be there. Yeah, but occasionally they say something, you know, of course. Occasionally, but there is this very interesting dynamic of a little bit of inquiry, but a lot of questioning. What's my role, Muji? What's my role? Tell me what my role. Show me what my role. Here to Guru, show me my role. I need to know what my role is. Again, don't have a role. Don't have a role. So, that's a mind blower. See, that changes everything. The snake goes, ah! Right? The snake suddenly loosens up. The constriction is like, oh, I can breathe again. My gosh, I can breathe. Holy cow. And if you go to a retreat, satsang, etc., watch the dynamic and look at it this way. And look at it that look at all these the women that they so dominate the whole new age, the whole religion, what's going on, they're so dominated, so incredible. That for a man, I say it's not even worth even, you know, going to satsang or anything, not even worth it. You feel just that you're there, you know, as a token, just shut up, don't say anything. Don't interfere and stay out of the way and thanks for coming, goodbye. Because again, this is the end of one cycle and begin another, and the women are desperate to know what their role is in this new cycle. And the Guru should say, you know, I'm only here to tell you in salvation you don't have any role. So if you're, you know, obsessed with what your role is, it means you want to go into a new cycle, and you're trying to find what your role, you're trying to recover your power. A lot of females are trying to recover their sense of you know, sheer domination without any, you know, deferential aspect to it. They want to get the hard edge, and a lot of them are, you know, the hard edge to it, actually. They want that real power, you know. They want the velvet fist, take the velvet off the fist to you know, get the ball rolling. So they go to a guru saying, I need to be enlightened. What they mean is they need to get some sense of empowerment so that they want to get into their role of power more. They want to get that power role going. That's what's going on. And a few, you know, do come for enlightenment. Yeah, absolutely. But it's still, there's a lot of question about the role, again. So. Women are very different than men, actually. I spent years just observing men and women walking down, stalking a boulevard, just pure observation. And I found women absolutely dominate the men. They do it, they're a half step quicker, they do it through body language, gestures. They're quicker, way quicker. They know what's going on before the men do. And they've already mapped out a strategy. And so the men are like a half step behind at all times. Always. The only way to see, I was just completely still, no thought, just pure observation. And I could see. I was able to see this. I was like, wow. Wow, wow, wow. Men don't even know what's going on. They don't even know they're being controlled. They really don't. They think, you know, women are so clever at it, too. They're so clever at making the man think that he's in control. But they're really, they're a half step ahead at all times. Amazing, 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 amazing. They catch this quick, see that? Okay, read the situation. guy is just kind of, okay, you know, and they've already, you know, already mapping out the road, paving the road ahead of which way it's going to go. Okay, I'm going to go this way, I'm going to go that way. Body language, body positioning, gestures, everything, you know, is just, wow. Control, 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 control. The man is just like a robot, kind of servant. You know, it's just amazing. And when you see it, you're just dumbfounded. Dumbfounded. Men don't have a chance. Absolutely don't have a chance in this world. They're dreaming if they think they do. Absolutely not. But as long as the men are picking a lot of cotton, you know, the women say, well, hey, you guys are doing a great job. Just pick a little faster. That's all. And when they stop picking so much cotton, that's when they start cracking the whip. What's the matter with you guys? You know, get back to work. So, it's very different. Very different. And so their approach to stop selling actually is going to be very different. Because they're sizing the guru up. They're looking at the guru and saying, how can I... Because this guru, what's his power? Or her power, if it's a female guru. But what's his power? And how can I get him to use that power to give me a great role? I want to play a great role here. I want to have a lot of power. And so of course, on the service, they're playing all these games of inquiry, blah, blah. Who is talking? Where's the me? Show me little me. And they're doing all that's going on. The bigger focus is there's a bigger focus going on, is how can I get a great role? How can I get this guru to help me, you know, get a great starring role in the play of salvation? Females are fabulous actresses, actually. Fabulous, incredible, unbelievable how talented they are at acting, pretending, putting on facades, etc., etc. So they put on a facade with the guru. It's an act. It's an act. An act. Oh, lots of tears, all this sort of stuff. But there's another intelligence there, a ferocity. What's my role? What's my role? I gotta find out. Gotta find out. So the end game is not to discover they don't have a role. The end game is to discover what their role is. And the role of the guru is to say, you don't have a role. And of course, that just makes them even more like worship the guru. Oh, okay, guru, I'll worship you, I'll worship you, I'll worship you. And they get very devotional and worshipful and stuff. But all that, again, is an attempt to extract a role out of the guru, actually. So, tough go for the guru here, I'm telling you that. Very tough. That's what Muji said. I don't recommend being a guru to anyone. That is for sure. That's an honest statement there. It seems like that was his destiny. So he's you know, caught in it, as it were. He's up to his neck in it. And that's a real, real tough go. Real tough go. And he gets very frustrated. It's funny. I've heard a lot of his audio, and it's very interesting. Some at his house, they're just cooking and talking, and he gets frustrated with the women, very frustrated. He says, I've told you this stuff so many times, you don't get it at all, you know, da, da, da. And the women just, you know, just keep on, Moji, I'm kind of psychological, on and on and on and on. They're just trying to figure out how to get this guru to give out the goodies. That's it. It's a negotiation. It's a bargain. They're shopping. They're shopping. Shopping for a role. They're great shoppers, you know. Super shrewd shoppers. They're bargaining. They're haggling with the guru. And Buji says, don't haggle with me, you know. I'm tired of this. Forget the haggling. Drop it all. Come on. Just realize we've never been here. You know, nobody's here. There's nothing. There's nothing. So you have to cut the guru some slack, actually. You know, they're under a lot of duress, a lot of duress. Look out for the quote of the gurus, the sages who are into naming everything, renaming everything. Very bad, very bad. That creates a cult. The way they create cults is to give names to everything, and only the inner circle knows what the names are. And what they say is that they're God, and they know the true names of everything. And so what happens is then you build up this pyramid going up to the inner circle. Up to the top is the guru, who supposedly knows the real names of everything. And the guru is then renaming, telling whispering to the inner circle, the real name is this. And they rename the people. Each person gets a new name. This is your real name. You know? And but it extends to renaming lakes, where they, you know, landmarks, landscapes, names of trees, plants, flowers, everything. They rename, they get into this renaming. And what happens is you feel like you're part of, you have inside information. Everybody else who's calling other names, they don't know anything. They don't know the names of anything. They're ignorant. And so you're a part of a special inner circle that is blessed to actually know the names of stuff. Like, this is lake. Everybody's called this lake Lake Blue for thousands of years. And then the guru says, you know, I'll tell you what the name of this lake really is. It's Lake, you know, Azul or something. Or Lake Aqua. Lake Aqua. This is Lake Aqua. And everyone goes, ah, now we know the name. And nobody else knows the name. So when people says, oh, I'm going to Lake Blue, they say, Lake Blue? There is no Lake Blue. You don't know the name, do you? I tell you what, you need to come to the guru and take satsang. And if you're really blessed, the guru might tell you what the name of the lake really is. Oh, really? Well, the truth is nothing has a name. There are no names. There are no faces. There are no names. Everything is nameless and faceless, actually. So poof, there goes the cult, you know, right there. The whole cult thing, multi-level. The guru only telling the real names to those who have done the most worship, the most seva, the most donations, the most worship, you know. The guru chooses those favorites and says, okay, I'm gonna impart, you know, what your real spiritual name is, what the name of other people are. I mean, the guru might tell the inner circle what the spiritual names of the rest of the people are, but they won't even tell the rest of the people what their names are, you know. So the inner circle says, well, I know what your real name is, you see. And there's power, right? It's power. Oh, really? Please tell me. Well, you're not quite ready yet. You're not quite ready yet. And this is the key to cults, actually. You can be a cult buster by realizing that nothing has any name. There are no names. There are no names at all. Everything is named. It's all completely nameless. Is a lake there? No, there's no lake. There's no name. There's not a lake. That's a name. We look at names. We don't realize that what is there doesn't have any name. So it's pretty easy to avoid the real bad stuff by avoiding those who do all this naming stuff, you know. And if you start feeling this whole thing like it's all this, you know, was, hey, you know, we're renaming all this building is now named this. See that tree out front? This is the name of that tree. And oh man, that gets heavy. You should say, what tree? That tree right there. Say, I don't see any tree. What do you mean tree? There are no trees. I don't see trees. There's just one. There's just oneness. There's just the one. That's it. So the vision of oneness is the ultimate cult buster, as it were. And the same thing about roles, that the guru plays the same thing. It The guru gives out all these roles, constant names, roles, all that stuff. This is your role. And if you really get close to the guru, you'll get clued in to what your role is. So the bad dark gurus exploit this whole dynamic, especially with the women. They exploit the women, their desire to know what the roles are. They play mind games with them and say, hey, I'll tell you what your role really is. And then they tell them, you know. And then later on, they say, well, actually, you actually have an even higher role, but I didn't want to tell you yet, you know, that kind of thing. But you're not quite ready, you know, to know that. So women do get exploited in these cults. There's no question about it, because the guru knows this and is cynically, you know, exploiting it for their own aggrandizement. That's true. On the other hand, women also foster this overall situation by demanding that they know what their roles are and being intensely interested. Oh, you know what my role is? And then, oh, okay, and treating them like a god worshiping. Just please let me know. So it's a double-edged thing. It's a double-edged thing. And there are gurus who actually cynically exploit that. Yes, that is so. Absolutely, it is so. But women should not play the Little Miss Innocent about it. That's nonsense. They absolutely play a central role in ferociously seeking and demanding what their roles are. And so they're, you know, they have to accept responsibility for that. Get a better guru, or, you know, do the work. Do the work of clarification. Stop blaming the blame game, as it were. Because you can always find someone stupid, you can manipulate them into being a guru and play this game of assigning your roles, etc. You can always, you know, women can do that easily. But it's a waste of time. Somebody's calling. The boss is calling, as it were. One of the bosses. Yeah. Okay, so we've gotten into some heavy, heavy, heavy territory, but celebrate it. That's the whole purpose. Get into the nitty-gritty of it, actually, right now. So that snake lets go a little bit, because it stunned the snake. You know, the snake doesn't think you're going to hear this. It does not. And when you hear this, you know, instead of reacting angrily or something, what are you talking about? It's like, hey, the snake, I feel like the snake doesn't like this. That's cool. Yeah, it really bothers the snake that's constricting us into another cycle of mortality training. Yeah, this is cool. I like it. That's the spirit. Get it, and get a little chuckle out of it, too. And realize, hey, you know what? Those big bad gurus, you know, the exploitive gurus, they don't seem so clever anymore now, do they? No, they don't. Yeah, the whole thing is kind of lightening up, isn't it? A lot of light is pouring through now, through the fabric, you know, a lot of light. And of course, what we see is like, oh, wow, that's amazing, yeah. We can look at it with a clear eye and not a cynical eye, or, you know, so it's not good to get cynical. No. You have to have a sense of humor, you have to, and see it clearly, but not with all this, you know, real negative cynicism. You have to get clearer than that, so you actually see it. It's not easy, but when you see it, you say, okay, it is what it is. Okay, now let's be wise, smart about it. Let's be wise about this whole thing. Let's be wise about it. But I tell you what, you know, it's amazing that the last 50 years, it's just like amazing. It just what's happened in the gurus and the spiritual teachers, I mean, it's like the women just left the men in the dust. Because they're preparing, you know, when women are preparing for a baby, a new baby, how they're so intense, so energized, so focused. I mean, men are just, you know, not even on their radar unless they need something. It's just like, you know, they have something, they're going to give birth. It's that way when a new cycle comes. The women, the females, are so intensely focused on this new cycle that men don't even exist unless they need them for something. You use them for some reason, but and then they see these gurus and they just descend like locusts on them, you know, and just like, hey, you know, are you the doctor who's going to help me give birth to this new cycle? You know, Dr. Muji, you're going to help me give birth to the doctor, huh? Okay, whatever. So they want to get help with this new cycle. They think the guru is the, you know, hey, we'll make you the figurehead of the new cycle. We'll worship you. You'll be the new guru, the new god of this cycle, new guru. Yeah, yeah. Please, 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 please help us out. Help us out with this mortality training so we don't have to face the continuity issue because we're absolutely terrified of it. Ah, but guess what? The Holy Spirit's already solved the continuity problem. How about that? Yeah, no fear, no worries. No need for a new cycle of mortality. But, all right, so the world thinks, you know, that it's getting away with all this stuff, but it's not. It's extracting a fearsome price from us, yeah. But we're going to extract a price from the world for sure, which is to drop out of the program. And the world doesn't see that coming at all. It really doesn't. Yes, it's probably the Christian ascension, as it were, the rapture, Christian rapture. It's just simply those who decided to drop out of the mortality program. And it's not so much that they're ascending, it's that the others are descending, actually. That's actually what happens. It's very relative, right? I mean, sometimes when you see two things, you're not sure, you know, is someone going forward or the other's going backwards? Like you have two cars and you're at a stoplight and you think, oh my gosh, I'm going backwards. Whereas the other car's actually going forward. You trick that way. So we think, oh, this ascension's going to happen. Except, you know, it could very well be a fact of more of a descension into a new cycle of mortality training. Extreme descent into that will simply make it seem like some are just like ascending like crazy. You know, it's like, wow. It could be a lot, you know, a lot to that, actually. So the fear of ascension should not be there so much, actually. We're probably almost already there, actually. I feel I am. If something suddenly drops away, whew, descends quickly, you might think, oh my God, I'm ascending, and freak out. No. You may be pretty much right where you have always been, or are right now. You know? Maybe it'll feel like, a lot of this stuff is now, you know, going away from me. But it's the descension that is probably happening. A tremendous collapse, a tremendous descent is going to happen, actually. A tremendous descent, a quick descent. Ah, very good. In the world, this is the collapse I've been talking about. Is the world is suddenly going to collapse, but what it really is a descent, a very rapid descent into another realm of mortality training, a very dark, very heavy, very dense, very intense, you know, mortality training. And it's going to happen very fast. And this is, we're feeling this sense of, uh-oh, it's about to happen, right? It's about to happen. And so we're worrying about our ascension. We need to ascend. Now that this, just let the descent happen and just sidestep it, just get out of the way of it, so to speak, and you'll be fine. You'll be having a good laugh at some point for sure. And it's a great relief, I think, for women to realize they don't need to play any role, because they feel like this central role they play in the mortality training is such a burden. It's just like so, like they feel they just have to do it all and multitask and everything. And just to realize, you know what, I don't have any role to play. I'm just enjoying this beatific vision. That's it. Huge relief. It's not an ego-busting type of thing at all, no. It's like relief. Thank God that you know, you don't have to always be on stage as the star of the show. And now you're just seeing this nameless, faceless oneness, and you're seeing this incredible beauty, and that's just all that's there, and that's all you need to do. That's it. You don't need to be pretending anything. You don't need to be cracking any whips. You don't need to be telling anyone what to do. What a vast relief that is, yeah. All right. But I guess the whip is cracking on me, and I need to prepare some food. So, here we go, here we go, here we go. Get ready for the descent. The collapse is a descent, a sudden descent, a dropping of the consciousness. It's not a raising of the consciousness, it's a dropping of the consciousness, a severe drop, actually. That, of course, if you're upside down, you think it's progress, right? Oh, I seem to be rising, right, as everything descends, and you're upside down, and you think, oh, I'm ascending, I'm making progress, whereas you're going down, 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 down. So, yeah, if you're upside down, you're inverted, it might seem that way, but it's really a very huge descent into another cycle. Shaking that detergent bottle one more time. See how the bubbles flow. That's what it is. Boring, right? Boring. Been there, done that. Okay. Very great. That's it. That's it. That's it.